Hello everyone, so here we are back with another first look video, and today I have to show you a GPO Silver Jubilee compact phone. Now it's just come in today, I received it this morning, so I just thought I'd give you a look at the condition of it. It's a bit dirty, as you can see, the handset cord there, oh sorry, the curly cord from the phone to the bell unit, that's a bit grubby. But they're in good condition though. And here's a look at the phone. It needs a good clean and a polish, as you can see. It's got a few marks on it. The dial's a bit dirty there. You can see the silver Jubilee emblem is upside down. So the dial's a bit scratchy sounding. Speed of it's not too bad. But yeah, that would benefit from a lubrication. Here's the handset. It's a bit dull, as you can see. So yeah, it does need a good polish. Got the original transmitter and receiver by the looks of it. There's the hook switch, which doesn't seem to be working very well. We'll have a look at that. And this would be where the number card would sit. The little plastic cover is missing. I think I have one of those. I'll try and track that down. See, it's a bit dirty there. So there you go, that's the phone. Now, the compact phone was designed to sit on a windowsill, which is why the depth of it is quite small. And the bell actually was in a separate unit like this. As you can see, this is the bell unit. That's dated 77, so that is original to this phone. I noticed it was missing the metal wall mount that would have slid onto the back of here, so you could mount the bell unit to the wall. But speaking of wall mounts, it also came with the matching wall mount for the phone. So what was really cool about this is this this piece. Flap, whatever you want to call that, lifted out, and you'd take the plastic cover off this bell unit and the bell unit would actually sit inside this wall mount here, and then you would put the little flap back in place and you would take the little metal piece, which I told you was missing, off the back of the bell unit, and that would slide into the back here, which would enable you to mount the wall mount here onto the wall. So that would hold the bell and also fix that to the wall, but it would also hold the phone as well. The phone would sit on top of the wall mount there. So you have your phone and the bell all in one place. But of course, you didn't have to have this. I guess that would have cost extra. You could have just had the phone on a table or whatever, and then the bell fixed down near the skirting board, perhaps. But yeah, that's that. So that's cool. That's quite a rare thing to have, the matching wall mount. There's no damage on the phone or the bell unit. The only damage there was, which there wasn't before until I got it, when I opened this flap here to see how the bell unit sat in the wall mount there. The little tab which it clicks in when you sit it in there and seat it down, it clicks into position, and of course the flexing of the plastic, with it being old, it's brittle, so that snapped, but I managed to glue it back on with some super glue. So that'll be fine, that'll hold. It's not detrimental anyway. It's not necessary for it to stay sat in there, that flap. It just stops it from falling out like that if you tip it upside down. But that's that anyway. That's the only damage, which is very minimal, and it doesn't affect the phone in any way. So here's the underside of the phone. It's got the markings all still intact, which is good. And all the rubber feet are still there. So I think I've shown you everything there is to show you on the outside. That's a bit discoloured, but that's nothing really. What I'll do is I'll open up the phone and the bell unit and we can have a quick look inside. Okay, so I have the casings removed, so now we can take a look inside the telephone itself and the bell unit. So if you have one of these compact phones, I would really recommend that you remove the finger wheel before you try and prise the case off, because you'll find that there's too much thickness on the dial here to prise this case forward and backwards to remove it. This thin plastic edge would more than likely snap if you stretch that right over the dial with the finger wheel in place. So to be on the safe side, go ahead and remove that finger wheel. It'll make your life a lot easier and you'll have less screaming and pulling your hair out at the end. So anyway, that little side note there. So here's a look inside the telephone. It's rather Heath Robinson looking, isn't it? Anyway, there we have the dial. It's got some nice blue numbers. I didn't notice that before. I just thought they were black, but they're actually blue to match the phone. So that's cool. So just turn it around to the back. Okay, so we have terminals T1 to T9. And then we have the transmitter and receiver terminals there. It's rather bizarre the way that they've labelled these terminals, but anyway, there we have the switch hook, which is a bit dodgy at the moment. I'll have to have a look at that. But anyway, that sits in there somehow. It's hard to do with one hand. There we go, it's under sort of spring-loaded. There you go. Spring-loaded tension there. Well, there you can see we have the, oops, a bit out of focus there. There we go, the capacitor, have a rectifier there and a few other components. Let's see if we can see the date on the dial. Oops, pulling the cards out there. There we have the card from the phone to the bell unit, and then we have the handset card on the other side. Now, how do we remove the dial? I have had a compact before, but it's been a while, so... Ah, yes. So I'm just going to quickly remove the dial here. So, it looks pretty clean, actually. So there we have our date. Let's see what it says. So the dial is from 1974. It's made by SLW. You can just see that there, hopefully. 74. Okay, so whether the dial's original or not, I'm not sure. I would imagine it would be, with it being earlier than the phone. The phone is 77. But there we go, that's the phone. A bit dusty inside, as I would expect. But all the connections look as they should. So here's a look at the bell unit. Now this is the proper Jubilee phone bell unit, because it has the connections on one side. The later compact phone that I had, that had the later bell unit, I think it was from 81, the bell unit that I had for my other compact, that had connections on both sides, and it had like a multicoloured ribbon type cable that went, took the connections to the other side, which was rather bizarre. We have the earlier bells. You'll find in the late 70s and 80s they changed one of the bells to a, I'm not sure what it was made of, it might have been steel, but they just sounded out of tune from each other. But these are the, those are the original GPO bells. So we have a single coil ringer there. You can see the clapper there, and we look like we have the original line card there, of course, being it was hardwired originally. So they've just cut those off. I think that's what that's for anyway, the original line card. But anyway, there we go. That's a look inside the phone. It's a bit dirty. I won't be using this anyway, because I'll be putting the bell unit inside the wall mount to keep it all together. But there's the Silver Jubilee GPO compact phone. So expect to see a final video on this. Sorry, this first look's gone on for rather a long time. I was expecting this to be a shorter video, but you know how things go and I get carried away talking. But anyway, Next time you see this, it'll be converted, cleaned, restored, polished, and ready for a demonstration. So until then, thanks for watching, and I'll see you again very soon. Take care.